later. Anyway, namaskar. It's an honor and a pleasure to be with you, and I want to thank Waves, and particularly Dr. Shashi Tiwari, who invited me, I must say, very late in the game, so that's why the summary of my presentation is indeed a summary. It's about 4 lines long. But I thought, given the expertise and the variety of talent and knowledge of the audience and participants, I would really not try to go into the Vedas or into the Upanishads, because that has been done many times over here, and I'm sure the audience is extremely familiar with it. So I will simply point to some of the fundamental scientific deductions that we can draw from the approach taken by Indic science or Indic knowledge, and compare it or identify it in contemporary science. And I will refer specifically to a couple of conferences, of course, some articles I wrote and some books also. But in particular, to a conference we held in April last in Dharamshala with the coordinator Dalai Lama and a few Indian and Western scientists on essentially the nature of science and its approach. And I will very briefly go over the conclusions, or rather upon the essential points made. Then I will briefly go through about 20 slides that give a more precise background. And then I will summarize in a few very concise points, given the lack of time. Now, first I want to point out that the definition that is very well known to you and the distinction, which is between paravidya and aparavidya, and very clearly when we are talking about science, natural or physical, we are talking about aparavidya. And it is very clear that the only paravidya deals with the absolute or the source, as it were, parabrahman. But we have a statement in the Vedas which tells us that, and this is repeated all along, that the sages have found through deep inquiry in their minds and hearts, they have found the connection of the relative to the absolute, or the finite to the infinite. So that connection is a fundamental point, and as we know, this is becoming very much at the heart, this is now at the heart of scientific inquiry, and we all know that science and scientific eminence is very much connected to power. So at the time when Asia is rising, we can expect and we can already see the importance of Asia, particularly India and China, in the field of scientific inquiry and in scientific leadership. And just like China is increasingly introducing concepts borrowed from Taoism and Confucianism in its scientific research and in its overall ethos, India has now the ability, the power, and the opportunity to essentially take the lead in scientific investigation. But for that, there has to be, of course, a distinction made between the approach taken in the last three centuries, and the traditional, original Indian perspective. And rather than looking for specific details as to whether there was a knowledge of the speed of light, for example, or many other such things which have been debated, we should really look at the constitutive fundamental principles of how to go about understanding the universe. And if you look at some of the seminal thinkers in Western, what we call Western civilization, modern civilization, we can point to Hegel in particular, who targeted Indian philosophy, saying, you see, Indians had wonderful poetry, but Sanskrit, by definition, is unfit for a scientific civilization because it is highly confusing in the sense that it has too many synonyms and it speaks in metaphors. And the ideal scientific language should have only one word for one thing, because that's a key to achieving rationality and therefore progress. Otherwise, you are wallowing in darkness. And that's what, of course, Hegel felt Indians had been doing for thousands of years. Now, this is precisely the core of the problem, because we are realizing, and there have been before me some speakers referring to the nature of language, we know that language, by definition, cannot be precise and cannot refer to one thing with one word. By definition, language is a set of metaphors.
And therefore, poetry may be our only escape from delusion. So that in itself is, of course, a very paradoxical statement to make if we are referring to scientific knowledge. But I think that's where we have to come. And we see now this happening everywhere because we have, just now there is another conference going on Abhinavagupta. And there is great debate about the nature of knowledge and discovery. And you know the notions of bhavana and pratibha. And pratibha is that intuitive flash of awareness, according to Kashmira Shaivism, which makes people aware of things and fully understanding how they are and how they work. And that itself is acknowledged by modern scientists because most of them say that the great discoveries have not come from just a lot of testing and investigation and research, but rather from a flash of intuition, of awareness. So pratibha is very much at the core of scientific discovery even now, but the problem is that then it has to be interpreted in the language of modern science and with modern methodology, and that's where we lose the point most of the time, because a lot of things that are being intuitively presented are seen as logically incoherent or impossible. So now, without further ado, I will go into very brief points that were made about, as I said, what science is telling us nowadays and where it is pointing to vidya and essentially becoming vidya. Now, I will probably sit down because I think I will not stand between you and the... Very quickly, though, because we don't have a lot of time, but you can read by, you know, see where I'm going. Kant said science can only exist if we have mathematics. Otherwise, it's not science. So it is not the laws of nature that scientists spell, but laws regulating phenomena that they can grasp, retrieved from an ocean, like a net to catch a fish above a certain size. If the fish is smaller, you will not be able to catch it, therefore it won't exist. So here we see that mathematics itself is a process which essentially abbreviates and clips reality to the point where it reduces the universe to some basic fundamental, or at least facts that we consider to be fundamental, but which probably are not, and which make us miss the forest for the trees. So science must be communicable. Something must refer to something already known to others. And meaning as such is what is called a strange attractor. I won't go into that. The physical world is increasingly seen as made of information, with energy and matter as incidentals. This goes back to John Wheeler. Now, some brief references, the golden number in nature, which we all know about, the fact that what is called Fibonacci's number in the West, but which in fact was derived by Fibonacci from the Arabs, who in turn had gotten it from India, all that is now known. Attractors, mathematical representations of sets of numerical values towards which systems tend to evolve and in which they remain. So here we have a very fundamental notion of dharma, you know, or rita. But rita, essentially the dharma of things, as in the Buddhist sense, you know, that they remain within a certain pattern. Why? Because that's their dharma. Now, knowledge sharing as symbolic interaction. Knowledge is not mechanically communicable, as the context and worldview are different from for each actor. So here we have the symbolic interaction theory. Symbols are used to create shared frame of meaning. Any scientific theory is intended to facilitate the insertion of new information at a proper place in what is already known. The problem with that is that a lot of discoveries are lost because we don't know how to insert them, therefore we just discard them or ignore them. And in a way, what is fundamental is to build and maintain consistency in a worldview. Otherwise, it's not possible to build the scientific corpus. Now, here we see that what we have concentrated on most of the time is the physics of matter energy. But the physics of information is fundamental. And as Sheldrake put it, information is statistically spread out within an infinite memory bank. Sheldrake's morphogenetic field. So the universe is a substratum of a meta-reality of the information structure. Consciousness travels across information packets and in the process creates space and time. See, we could make multiple references to the Vedas, to the Upanishads, to the Taittiriya Samhita, for example, but of course I will not go into that because you can make your own deductions. Now, on that basis, Jacques Vallée said, making a theory of everything on the basis of physics is probably not achievable. Jacques Vallée is one of the fathers of Silicon Valley, you might put it that way. And he says, in fact, what we need is a theory of everything else, which is a theory of information. Now, erratic events as fragments of a larger system. The main feature of our universe is that it is erratic. Here I'm taking conclusions that are generally accepted or at least admitted in contemporary physics. Take numbers, for example. Those which don't have any regularity and cannot be generated by any rules, such as prime numbers, are the most numerous. And the erratic character of reality can be rationalized by assuming that we only know it in a moment, in momentary states of dynamic processes, which appear incoherent when seen apart from the whole. Take an earthquake. It's one of the most chaotic events you could witness. But if you look at the overall structure of over a very long period of time, then you see an earthquake is taking part as a sort of an accelerated process within an overall pattern which involves the drift of continents and the evolution of the planet, of the planet's structure. So the only perfect model of reality is reality itself and not any of the images we have or make of it, which is a fundamental concept that science has great trouble with, you know, because science claims to be able to give a very precise account, or at least it did claim to. Now, here we are just to illustrate, you know, the connections between the Mandelbrot sets and the clouds, which shows that nature abides by this fractal geometry, which means that every so-called finite surface or finite line is in fact infinite if you look at its components. Essentially, finitude is an appearance of infinity. Now, of course, here there are a number of statements and conclusions which drive us to believe that in terms of logics or rash reason, the universe does not make sense. At least this is what many of the prevalent views in science are. And I will not read all these because, as I said, I do not want to consume too much time. But we are not able to reconcile observations with theories or predictions in many cases. And in particular, the notion of naturalness, which was Einstein's pet theory, you know, that somehow everything has to be reconciled with human reason because that is essentially the guideline, right? And this is, of course, the laws of nature are sublimely beautiful, inevitable, and self-contained. But now physicists face the harsh prospect that those laws are just an arbitrary, messy outcome of random fluctuations in the fabric of space-time. I think we're hearing random fluctuations right now. Now, I quote here Neil Turok from the Perimeter Institute, which is one of the cutting-edge research centers. And you know, basically what he says is that the extensions of the standard model, like the grand unified theories, were supposed to simplify the standard model. But in fact, they made it more complicated. The number of parameters in the standard model is about 18. The number in grand unified theories is typically 100. In supersymmetric theories, the minimum is 120. And as you may have heard, string theory seems to predict 10 times the power of 1,000 different possible laws of physics. I want, it's called the multiverse. And he says it's ultimate catastrophe that theoretical physics has led to this crazy situation where the physicists are utterly confused and seem to have, not to have any predictions at all. Now, this is, of course, very much the notion of avidya when you are trying to understand things from an analytical, purely logical, observational perspective. Now, that's why we're coming to a definition of science which could be seen as anthropic science, which is an art, in a sense, cosmos in the human image. Human beings, on the basis of their insight, build out of the information they gather an imaginary world in such a way that it never contradicts the real world as they experience it. A physical theory based on some analogies with human behavior would be most suitable to account for the erratic nature of a hyper-complex universe. So we are going back to a sort of a pantheistic universe, which in a sense has many of the features of a living being, or even of a human being, if you were to call it, you know, Bhagavan, essentially. So the opposite of chaos theory, it turns a mechanistic mathematical worldview into an anthropomorphic one, chaos in order rather than order in chaos. And the central feature of living systems is the non-linearity of their dynamics, a property of chaos. Now here we go, I will just briefly evoke the rhizome structure, which is far more appropriate to describe the universe than the hierarchical tree structure. You find these rhizomes at all levels. You find it, for example, in botany, because we know that in forest, there is an internet of fungus beneath the earth, which connects the trees. Now, very fundamental point, are laws of nature invariant, eternal, and set? There are plenty of reasons they are not. Now we regard laws as habits. In other words, nature develops habits over certain periods of time, and in a particular universe or subset of the universe. But these laws do change. For example, now there is plenty of evidence that the speed of light is not a fixed speed. It evolves, it moves. International Standard Institute, which are in set, you know, with the purpose of measuring exactly the speed of light, have had to agree that they only have approximate measurements because they can't measure the same speed twice in two different places. So I will not go into the details. You can read them, and I'm sure that there will be a publication later of the papers presented here. So, for example, many laws of nature are found not to extend to a larger framework, such as entropy applied to the universe as a whole. Nonlinear systems do not tend towards entropy. So any attempt to imagine a given order to the universe results in making it look even more disorderly. And of course, here we are back to the Bhagavad Gita. This was said before, yesterday, I believe. I am the game of dice. You know, as opposed to Einstein's statement that God does not play dice, here we find that, in fact, the only thing that you can conclude about the universe is that it is a game of dice. The universe is erratic even for an infinite mind. God does not play with dice. Dice play with him. Now, the constructor theory, this is an interesting theory because it essentially tells us why and how physical structures come into being. And again, I know that we are being pressed for time, so the difference between quantum space and geometric space is an important feature of the cosmology of that is emerging, and in particular the notion that space-time may be self-generating or autopoietic, which is very much what you find in the Vedas, you know, Nishadiya Sukta. Now, exchange is a fundamental process. The field theory as the ultimate reality is now being reviewed. The new fundamental theory is based on information exchange among physical processes. Those processes then must build knowledge out of that information to inform their behavior. The adaptive laws of evolution may be applicable to the universe and to all its components, which means the universe is actually an evolving being, which means that it doesn't behave every day the same way. In fact, it probably doesn't behave even for 1 second the way that it did before. And of course, that negates a lot of the principles of scientific methodology. The laws of nature may be provisional and not just because of our observational limitations. Hence, prediction and replication have limited use for verification. Truth statements are rather fractal truth quotients. Falsification makes little sense in nonlinear dynamic systems. Natural laws may result from individual or collective acts of the entities regulated by them. So the physical universe may be regulated by laws derived from the behavior of its components according to a total conscious process. And that's, of course, the infinite freedom that is very often alluded to by Abhinavagupta. You know, that Swatantriya, that Swatantra of Shiva. Now, there are some comparisons here which are very visually evocative, you know, to see, of course, the microcosm and microcosm and how they are essentially reproducing and reflecting each other. And now, researchers say that our consciousness is not a continuous stream of input. Instead, the brain processes information in small chunks up to 400 milliseconds, and the unconsciousness gaps in between are then rendered out, which means that you perceive reality and then your mind takes 400 milliseconds approximately to order it and give you the picture. But what is there before you actually form the picture, we don't know, and we probably can never know in the sense of knowing through senses. But we can learn or know it through samadhi, consciousness. And scientists say this two-step model of processing demonstrates a small gap for retrospective processing before we become aware. So awareness comes later. I'm talking about conscious visual sensorial awareness. So seeing all things and events as separate and distinct is an intellectual convention for the sake of intelligibility. However, that mode of perception makes all observable reality look erratic. A holistic vision of all components and their interactions makes sense out of the apparent chaos. Now, double causality, I won't go into that. That's a very interesting theory which shows that the past affects the future, which in turn affects the present. Again, the past, the time doesn't flow. Like Harsha said, you know, there is no flow of time because if it flowed, where would it flow in? It would flow into another time. Interface theory of perception. Again, this is borrowed from computers, but it gives you a sense. What we see are icons on a computer screen. Very gross assimilation, but it does make, nowadays, it's very telling for, especially for the younger generations. And here, again, textiles, text, and fractal crystals. Won't go into that. It gets us into string and superstring theory. Quasi-crystals and Penrose's paving. Again, this, very much I make the reference to Indrajal, you know, the net of Indra, which has become the net of the Buddha in Mahayana Buddhist, especially Avatamsaka Sutra. Continuity and discontinuity. Can't go into that. And it's interesting that in a very scientific experiment, we have shown how the perception is not is one of continuous events when, in fact, in reality, it is discontinuous. So at the end, we have to see that in order to proceed with an understanding of nature and reality, we have, in a sense, to reorganize knowledge and build a new mathematics, which is something that is being very much essentially required by very prominent researchers like Afghani Hamed in the US. But it's a, still a very marginal current, but it is gaining growing acceptance. And going back to Swami Vivekananda and Minkowski, because Minkowski, who was in a way the teacher of Einstein, was a reader and in a way a disciple of Swami Vivekananda, we see that essentially we are going back towards an absolute science, which is also natural philosophy in the sense of the Schelling, one of the 18th century, early 19th century German romantic mystic theosophist, restoring the unity of knowledge, man and nature. So I don't have time to go into other things. What I'd like to say is that there are now very fascinating insights. For example, the Santilli telescope, which is a concave telescope, has shown us that there are many otherwise invisible creatures that are now perceptible, not only in the outer universe, but also in the atmosphere amongst us, which justifies the entire vision of the Vedic cosmology, with a number of beings who are not necessarily physically perceptible to us, but which belong to parallel states of matter and consciousness, the devas, the asuras, you name them. There are so many different categories. These are now being actually visually detected through new technological methods. So we see a connection now between observational science and what we might call mystical or supramental insight. Thank you.
Thank you.
The laws of nature are sublimely beautiful, inevitable, and self-contained. But now physicists face the harsh prospect that those laws are just an arbitrary, messy outcome of random fluctuations in the fabric of space-time. I think we're hearing random fluctuations right now. Now, I quote here Neil Turok from the Perimeter Institute, which is one of the cutting-edge research centers. And, you know, basically what he says is that the extensions of the standard model, like the grand unified theories, were supposed to simplify the standard model. But in fact, they made it more complicated. The number of parameters in the standard model is about 18. The number in grand unified theories is typically 100. In supersymmetric theories, the minimum is 120. And as you may have heard, string theory seems to predict 10 times the power of 1,000 different possible laws of physics. I want, it's called the multiverse. And he says it's ultimate catastrophe that theoretical physics has led to this crazy situation where the physicists are utterly confused and seem to have, not to have any predictions at all. Now, this is, of course, very much the notion of avidya, when you are trying to understand things from an analytical, purely logical, observational perspective. Now, that's why we're coming to a definition of science which could be seen as anthropic science, which is an art, in a sense, cosmos in the human image. human beings, on the basis of their insight, build out of the information they gather an imaginary world in such a way that it never contradicts the real world as they experience it. A physical theory based on some analogies with human behavior would be most suitable to account for the erratic nature of a hyper-complex universe. So we are going back to a sort of a pantheistic universe, which in a sense has many of the features of a living being, or even of a human being, which you call it, you know, Bhagavan, essentially. So the opposite of chaos theory, it turns a mechanistic mathematical worldview into an anthropomorphic one, chaos in order rather than order in chaos. And the central feature of living systems is the non-linearity of their dynamics, a property of chaos. Now here we go, I will just briefly evoke the rhizome structure, which is far more appropriate to describe the universe than the hierarchical tree structure. You find these rhizomes at all levels. You find it, for example, in botany, because we know that in forest, there is an internet of fungus beneath the earth, which connects the trees. Now, very fundamental point, are laws of nature invariant, eternal, and set? There are plenty of reasons they are not. Now we regard laws as habits. In other words, nature develops habits over certain periods of time, and in a particular universe or subset of the universe. But these laws do change. For example, now there is plenty of evidence that the speed of light is not a fixed speed. It evolves, it moves. International Standard Institute, which are in set, you know, with the purpose of measuring exactly the speed of light, have had to agree that they only have approximate measurements because they can't measure the same speed twice in two different places. So I will not go into the details. You can read them, and I'm sure that there will be a publication later of the papers presented here. So, for example, many laws of nature are found not to extend to a larger framework, such as entropy applied to the universe as a whole. Nonlinear systems do not tend towards entropy. So any attempt to imagine a given order to the universe results in making it look even more disorderly. And of course, here we are back to the Bhagavad Gita. This was said before, yesterday, I believe. I am the game of dice, you know, as opposed to Einstein's statement that God does not play dice. Here we find that, in fact, the only thing that you can conclude about the universe is that it is a game of dice. The universe is erratic even for an infinite mind. God does not play with dice. Dice play with him. Now, the constructor theory, this is an interesting theory because it essentially tells us why and how physical structures come into being. And again, I know that we are being pressed for time, so the difference between quantum space and geometric space is an important feature of the cosmology of that is emerging. And in particular, the notion that space-time may be self-generating or autopoietic, which is very much what you find in the Vedas, you know, Nishadiya Sukta. Now, exchange is a fundamental process. The field theory as the ultimate reality is now being reviewed. The new fundamental theory is based on information exchange among physical processes. Those processes then must build knowledge out of that information to inform their behavior. The adaptive laws of evolution may be applicable to the universe and to all its components, which means the universe is actually an evolving being, which means that it doesn't behave every day the same way. In fact, it probably doesn't behave even for 1 second the way that it did before. And of course, that negates a lot of the principles of scientific methodology. The laws of nature may be provisional and not just because of our observational limitations. Hence, prediction and replication have limited use for verification. Truth statements are rather fractal truth quotients. Falsification makes little sense in nonlinear dynamic systems. Natural laws may result from individual or collective acts of the entities regulated by them. So the physical universe may be regulated by laws derived from the behavior of its components according to a total conscious process. And that's, of course, the infinite freedom that is very often alluded to by Abhinavagupta. You know, that swatantriya, that swatantra of Shiva. Now, there are some comparisons here which are very visually evocative, you know, to see, of course, the microcosm and microcosm and how they are essentially reproducing and reflecting each other. And now, researchers say that our consciousness is not a continuous stream of input. Instead, the brain processes information in small chunks of up to 400 milliseconds, and the unconsciousness gaps in between are then rendered out, which means that you perceive reality, and then your mind takes 400 milliseconds, approximately, to order it and give you the picture. But what is there before you actually form the picture, we don't know, and we probably can never know, in the sense of knowing through senses. But we can learn or know it through samadhi, consciousness. And scientists say this two-step model of processing demonstrates a small gap for retrospective processing before we become aware. So awareness comes later. I'm talking about conscious visual sensorial awareness. So seeing all things and events as separate and distinct is an intellectual convention for the sake of intelligibility. However, that mode of perception makes all observable reality look erratic. A holistic vision of all components and their interactions makes sense out of the apparent chaos. Now, double causality, I won't go into that. That's a very interesting theory which shows that the past affects the future, which in turn affects the present. Again, the past, the time doesn't flow, like Harsha said. You know, there is no flow of time, because if it flowed, where would it flow? It would flow into another time. Interface theory of perception. Again, this is borrowed from computers, but it gives you a sense. What we see are icons on a computer screen. Very gross assimilation, but it does make, nowadays, it's very telling for, especially for the younger generations. And here, again, textiles, text, and fractal crystals. Won't go into that. It gets us into string and superstring theory. Quasi-crystals and Penrose's paving. Again, this very much I make the reference to Indrajal, you know, the net of Indra, which has become the net of the Buddha in Mahayana Buddhist, especially Avatamsaka Sutra. Continuity and discontinuity, can't go into that. And it's interesting that in a very scientific experiment, we have shown how the perception is not, is one of continuous events, when in fact, in reality, it is discontinuous. So at the end, we have to see that in order to proceed with an understanding of nature and reality, we have, in a sense, to reorganize knowledge and build a new mathematics, which is something that is being very much essentially required by very prominent researchers like Afghani Hamed in the US. But it's still a very marginal current, but it is gaining growing acceptance. And going back to Swami Vivekananda and Minkowski, because Minkowski, who was in a way the teacher of Einstein, was a reader and in a way a disciple of Swami Vivekananda, we see that essentially we are going back towards an absolute science, which is also natural philosophy in the sense of the Schelling, one of the 18th century, early 19th century German romantic mystic theosophist, restoring the unity of knowledge, man and nature. So I don't have time to go into other things. What I'd like to say is that there are now very fascinating insights. For example, the Santilli telescope, which is a concave telescope, has shown us that there are many otherwise invisible creatures that are now perceptible, not only in the outer universe, but also in the atmosphere amongst us, which justifies the entire vision of the Vedic cosmology, with a number of beings who are not necessarily physically perceptible to us, but which belong to parallel states of matter and consciousness, the devas, the asuras, you name them. There are so many different categories. These are now being actually visually detected through new technological methods. So we see a connection now between observational science and what we might call mystical or supramental insight. Thank you.
Thank you. Perform this unpleasant duty of sending the slips, which I didn't want to, but everybody else will listen to each other, but then the time does not listen to us. When I was in BA first year, we had a poem in our court, and the poet had written, asked the clock to stop for a fraction of a second. I'll give you everything on this earth. Please do stop, but clock did not. So sorry for that. Now, before we go for the last paper, there's an announcement, and all of us will get together after the paper is over for a group photograph, because after this we'll be dispersing to different rooms. So we come over here and get the photograph, right? Now, the last paper titled the Chinese rationale behind Indian Kundalini Yoga by Koenraad, Elst. He has, to his credit, not only a PhD degree, but he has MA in three subjects, Sinology, Indology, and Philosophy from Belgium.
I would Kundalini Yoga, that title will probably already scare off some Indian nationalists. Joseph Needham is the kind of scholar that India too had needed and has never found. But so he did something for China, which is to write history of science and technology in China. He was from Cambridge, he died in 1995. And so there are several parts about alchemy, you see, and this is very much part of his history of science, because it's quite an achievement. It's not some superstition at all. First of all, he says that the word alchemy comes from Chinese. You see, some people think it comes from Arabic because of the prefix al, like algebra. But it is an Arabization of a Chinese word, kiamyak, which is all Chinese for potable gold. Gold liquid. Now, one thing he studies is why tan. Tan means alchemy for reasons we shall see. Why means outer. And so, this is about alchemy in the classical sense that you all heard about. It's about taking substances, which were the primitive form of what we now know as alimentary supplements, you know, vitamins and all those. Only, you know, they were groping around in the dark. And so they were experimenting. Like, for example, they were taking lead or they were taking mercury. And then sometime later they died. Now, if you take lead, it has the advantage that your corpse decomposes more slowly. So some of the pupils said, well, the master has died. He didn't do it perfectly yet. But at least his corpse is holding out. He was on the right track. Come on, let's try it, but better. And so quite a few people died, including the man who united China, Qin Shi Huang, the greatest emperor of all times, a tyrant, a terrible tyrant, but nevertheless very talented, very powerful, but also trying for eternal life, and so therefore a victim of this outer alchemy. So let's not spend too much time on that. At the same time, there is a totally different tendency, and the two come together in inner alchemy that we will see. This is the Yellow Emperor, the supposed founder of Chinese medicine. Interesting in this case is that there is a lot that points to a foreign origin. And so he's supposed to be the father of the Chinese writing system, among others. That may indicate that the writing system also came from elsewhere. And so the medical system also. Now in about 300 BC, there appeared the Neijing, the book of internal medicine, which practically has the complete system of acupuncture and so on that we now know, with the whole system of meridians and acupoints, and the system of pulse diagnosis. Then there is the system of energy practices that's also equally old. Like there you can see a painting from the 2nd century BC showing all kinds of physical exercises to stay supple. And this was very necessary in the valley of the Yellow River. People were having aching joints, were having arthritis and so on, things that you don't find much in India because of the climate. So it first started as a very practical way of relieving your joints. of creating space in the joints. But it evolved, and you got the practice of yang sheng, which means to feed life. And it is already mentioned by Zhuangzi in the 4th century BC. These dates are relatively important, as you shall see. For example, a famous practitioner of it was Dr. Hua Tuo, whom again we shall meet. Joseph Needham describes and quotes a text where a Chinese Buddhist visitor to India describes all the merits of Chinese science, and so he also talks about this Dr. Hua Tuo and the whole system of energy medicine. Then we come to Neitan, which means inner alchemy, and so this simply means the practice of energy exercises, pranayama, what you know Indians know as pranayama, and it is called alchemy in the sense that it uses the terms from outer alchemy in a metaphoric sense. And so ultimately the goal is to create a pill of longevity, of immortality inside the body by doing these exercises. And one very important exercise is the microcosmic orbit, which means to circulate by your attention the energy that is supposed to flow through the spine upwards and along the front side down. So there is a correspondence here with the heavenly movements, the way that the planets move around the sun, the energy moves around the body. There was also the practice of sexual alchemy, but since I have been summoned by the chairwoman to limit the time I spend, I will skip this. I only mention that some of it has reached India, where it is known as Chinachara, the Chinese practice. So it is the Indians themselves who acknowledge that certain things have come from China. Now they have a whole system of breathing exercises in China. For instance, some of them are very usual, like you have to concentrate on breathing and keeping your attention on the tip of the nose, which is exactly like the very first exercise that all students of Buddhism get to do, anapanasati, which is just watching the breath. Everyone in the whole world who ever has taken a hatha yoga course will remember that as the first breathing exercise. Now something more advanced is subtle breathing, which is called embryonic breathing, which is a very, very light, extremely light breathing, almost unhearable, unnoticeable. But let us jump to the important one. Lao Tzu says about breathing exercises and meditation exercises, a very simple formula that sums up perhaps not everything, but a great deal, which is to fill the belly and to empty the head. So you should let the breath sink and to concentrate on the lower abdomen. Now the important thing here is negative breathing. Negative breathing or reverse breathing means, whereas you learn in yoga all the time that you have to breathe in while filling the belly and breathe out while pulling the diaphragm up and, you know, emptying the belly, here you do the reverse. When you breathe in, you breathe in upwards, you know. You feel the upper part of your body. You empty the stomach, and when you breathe out, you relax. You let everything fall, so to speak. Okay. Now, we will see how that is of influence in India. Now, in about the 4th century, perhaps earlier, but it is at any rate identified in the 4th century, there was a trade in mercury, the chief product of alchemy, or the chief ingredient of the alchemical process, from China to India, overseas. You know, we know a lot about the relations overland through Central Asia, because that's also the route that Buddhism has taken. Now, here we talk about a different way across the sea, where they would start in Canton, in present-day Hong Kong, and end up on the Coromandel coast, the east coast of India, in Chennai or thereabouts. And this explains why in South India we find quite a bit of Chinese influence. Aha, where is it? You may have heard of the character Boganath or Bogar. So he was a medieval yogi who went to China. And this is not something I invent, you see, this is in all his biographies. He went to China and he learned practices there. Then he returned to India. Supposedly, his longevity was such that he is still alive. He's living in a cave underground somewhere. It's unfortunate that we can't see him. Just like Jesus, you see, he resurrected, and yet nobody has ever encountered him. But anyway, so the ideal of longevity, which was very central in China, also animated him, and to a very large extent. Now, you see, for example, I know of a text in Kerala, in the written version of this paper, all the references will be given, where the five elements are mentioned, but not in the order known in India, but that in China. You see, in India, they are a vertical series from earth to space, heavier, lighter. In China, they are circular. They are conceived as circular, and I won't go further into it. I only mention, you see, this Chinese system is attested inside India, not in the northwest, where you might expect it most, not near the Bamiyan Buddhas or thereabouts. No, you know, in the south. Now here we come to Hatha Yoga. You know, when people say, oh, you know, yoga was not invented, you know, Indians have practiced it all along. Well, you know, it's somewhat true. You know, you find all these characters in meditation posture on the seals in Harappa, but there is no Harappan seal that shows somebody standing on his head. And so these postures, you know, postural yoga is relatively recent, but not as recent as Western researchers say, that it is a British invention, that they learned it from British army drills, blah, blah, blah. No. Well, army has something to do with it in the sense that physical exercises, of course, always existed, you know, as martial exercises and dancers' exercises. And of course, the monks were also fighters. I mean, at least certain orders of monks, you know, lived in akharas, in wrestling places, and certainly practiced. And so that is one of the great inspiration sources. But at any rate, Hatha Yoga as a system is not older than 1000 AD. And so there are some exercises that are that recent, you know, and that perhaps will be associated with Hinduism in the rest of the world, but that are arguably of Chinese origin. The Khechari Mudra, the seal of she who flies through the sky, is like that. Now you find it in Chinese exercises since 2000 years ago. And so in India it appears only later. You see, there are ancient Indian breathing exercises, especially the Nadi Shodhana, this one. But there are others that are not mentioned before 1000 AD. However, this one has been taken to greater extremes in India. See, in India you have yogis who cut their tongue free from the base of the mouth so that they can push it deeper into this cavity internally. In China, they don't go that far. It simply means, you know, is intended to close the circle. You know, you go up and then you come here to the mouth and you link the channel you've gone through so far with the channel underneath by lifting the tongue. Now, in India, it goes a lot farther. It is meant to do something about the nectar. Then, more important, the Maha Mudra. You know, this exercise. You are supposed to bend forward, but with your heel against your perineum, the Shui Yin point in Chinese, and with your, if you take your right leg, if you push that outwards, you grab the toes with your right fingers, and you push your left middle finger onto a point on the sole of the foot, which is the first point of the kidney meridian in Chinese, the Yongchuan point, which is a very important point because it communicates the energy between the earth and the body. At the same time, you have to practice reverse breathing. So in the beginning, you push your thigh against your body, and at that time, you do not exhale because you push against the body. You might think, well, the body has less space, so exhale. No, you do the reverse. You inhale, but the body has less space, so you inhale towards the upper part. Reverse breathing. In yoga manuals, you will find that you have to do Uddiyana Bandha, which amounts to the same thing. But again, Uddiyana Bandha is part of Hatha Yoga, 1,000 years old. That is a respectable old age, but it is less than attested in China. Reverse breathing is very central in the yoga system of Yogi Bhajan, where they practice Satkriya. There are many other lesser exercises, but Satkriya specifically is that. You see, you create an upward dynamic by holding the arms like this and practicing reverse breathing. So when you breathe in, you direct the attention upwards. When you breathe out, you let it go. So the notion of Kundalini is very much linked with this reverse breathing. And there is no origin for that in Hindu tradition, not that I know of. Of course, here I'm starting a debate. Anybody who wants to know better than what I have found so far is perfectly welcome. Now, this whole thing was integrated in yoga in a way that you can't even recognize that it had a foreign origin. But that is normal. You see, if you see the manuals of Hindu astrologers, you wouldn't recognize that their system of at least birth astrology is of Hellenistic origin. And in fact, if you read the Greek texts, you would equally not find that it is originally of Babylonian origin. So you see, it is relatively normal that this got thoroughly integrated, but this happens mostly because there was a tradition in India of yoga in which this could be integrated in the first place. So, you know, all this is not at all to deny that the yoga tradition in India is native. It was there since the very beginning. So how indigenous is Kundalini? Well, you see, the notion of Kundalini itself is universal. You know, it can happen to you through any sudden event. People feel their Kundalini rise after an accident, or when they take drugs, you know, or some other mundane circumstance. And so it can exist separate from yoga. Strictly speaking, it has nothing to do with yoga, just as yoga has nothing to do with Kundalini. You have the Yoga Sutras and the Bhagavad Gita and so on, who don't talk about Kundalini at all. So just like the notion of God, which is not present in the description of yoga in the Katha Upanishad, for example, or the notion of reincarnation, which is also absent from some yoga texts, you see, this notion of Kundalini was added to yoga on top of it. It was not originally there. Important. The Bushman, oh, this is still my Dutch take, Bushman. You see, the Bushmen and the Australian Aboriginals and the Andaman tribes also have the notion of Kundalini. And they kindle the Kundalini, so to speak, by means of ecstatic dancing. I don't think I have already used my 30 minutes, but I am almost there. So, are there nonetheless Indian origins? Well, it is to be noted that the Chinese themselves located the origin abroad. You see, they went looking for these herbs in this outer alchemy abroad. They sent ships to Japan, for example. So they had a vague notion that elsewhere it was to be found, which is perhaps understandable because very few people have found a herb or an exercise or anything else at home that gave them immortality so far. So if it's not at home, hopefully it is somewhere else. So anyway, you see, then Joseph Needham also, in his discussion of this notion of longevity that the Chinese pursued with their exercises, that is not present in, for instance, Patanjali, but that is present in many modern manuals of Hatha Yoga, you know, that you increase your vitality, your longevity, and of course also your luster, your attractiveness for the opposite sex, which in the West is the absolutely number one reason why people take up yoga. You know, and yeah, but this is also mentioned in the Hatha Yoga classics, you know, that this is one of the effects of Hatha Yoga, you know, because that is what makes people do Hatha Yoga, and then hopefully later they will discover some more profound reasons, okay? But so, you see, all that, you know, Joseph Needham then starts to look for outside China. He says, you see, the Chinese clearly headed from somewhere, and that brings him to a study of the Soma notion in the Rig Veda, where Soma, of course, is also about immortality, about vitality, and so on. So perhaps India is in it for a little bit more than appears so far. And so anyway, this whole notion could only be integrated because India had a yoga tradition to begin with. Any remarks? Yes?
One question. After that, we'll have tea, and then you can talk.
Do with it in the sense that physical exercises, of course, always existed, you know, as martial exercises and dancers' exercises. And of course, the monks were also fighters. I mean, at least certain orders of monks, you know, lived in akharas, in wrestling places, and certainly practiced. And so that is one of the great inspiration sources. But at any rate, Hatha Yoga as a system is not older than 1000 AD. And so there are some exercises that are that recent, you know, and that perhaps will be associated with Hinduism in the rest of the world, but that are arguably of Chinese origin. The Khechari Mudra, the seal of she who flies through the sky, is like that. Now you find it in Chinese exercises since 2000 years ago. And so in India it appears only later. You see, there are ancient Indian breathing exercises, especially the Nadi Shodhana, this one. But there are others that are not mentioned before 1000 AD. However, this one has been taken to greater extremes in India. See, in India you have yogis who cut their tongue free from the base of the mouth so that they can push it deeper into this cavity internally. In China, they don't go that far. It simply means, you know, it's intended to close the circle. You know, you go up and then you come here to the mouth and you link the channel you've gone through so far with the channel underneath by lifting the tongue. Now in India it goes a lot farther. It is meant to do something about the nectar. then, more important, the Mahamudra. You know, this exercise, you are supposed to bend forward, but with your heel against your perineum, the Shui Yin point in Chinese, and with your, if you take your right leg, if you push that outwards, you grab the toes with your right fingers, and you push your left middle finger onto a point on the sole of the foot, which is the first point of the kidney meridian in Chinese, the Yongchuan point, which is a very important point because it communicates the energy between the earth and the body. At the same time, you have to practice reverse breathing. So in the beginning, you push your thigh against your body, and at that time, you do not exhale, because you push against the body, you might think, well, the body has less space, so exhale. No, you do the reverse, you inhale, but the body has less space, so you inhale towards the upper part. Reverse breathing. In yoga manuals, you will find that you have to do Uddiyana Bandha, which amounts to the same thing. But again, Uddiyana Bandha is part of Hatha Yoga, 1,000 years old. That is a respectable old age, but it is less than attested in China. Reverse breathing is very central in the yoga system of Yogi Bhajan, where they practice Satkriya. There are many other lesser exercises, but Satkriya specifically is that. You see, you create an upward dynamic by holding the arms like this and practicing reverse breathing. So when you breathe in, you direct the attention upwards. When you breathe out, you let it go. So the notion of Kundalini is very much linked with this reverse breathing. And there is no origin for that in Hindu tradition, not that I know of. Of course, here I'm starting a debate. Anybody who wants to know better than what I have found so far is perfectly welcome. Now, this whole thing was integrated in yoga in a way that you can't even recognize that it had a foreign origin. But that is normal. You see, if you see the manuals of Hindu astrologers, you wouldn't recognize that their system of at least birth astrology is of Hellenistic origin. And in fact, if you read the Greek texts, you would equally not find that it is originally of Babylonian origin. So you see, it is relatively normal that this got thoroughly integrated, but this happens mostly because there was a tradition in India of yoga in which this could be integrated in the first place. So, you know, all this is not at all to deny that the yoga tradition in India is native. It was there since the very beginning. So how indigenous is Kundalini? Well, you see, the notion of Kundalini itself is universal. You know, it can happen to you through any sudden event. People feel their Kundalini rise after an accident, or when they take drugs, you know, or some other mundane circumstance. And so it can exist separate from yoga. Strictly speaking, it has nothing to do with yoga, just as yoga has nothing to do with Kundalini. You have the Yoga Sutras and the Bhagavad Gita and so on, who don't talk about Kundalini at all. So just like the notion of God, which is not present in the description of yoga in the Katha Upanishad, for example, or the notion of reincarnation, which is also absent from some yoga texts, you see, this notion of Kundalini was added to yoga on top of it. It was not originally there. Important. The Bushman, oh, this is still my Dutch take, Bosjesman, Bushman. You see, the Bushman and the Australian Aboriginals and the Andaman tribals also have the notion of Kundalini. And they kindle the Kundalini, so to speak, by means of ecstatic dancing. I don't think I have already used my 30 minutes, but I am almost there.
So are there nonetheless Indian origins? Well, it is to be noted that the Chinese themselves located the origin abroad. You see, they went looking for these herbs in this outer alchemy abroad. They sent ships to Japan, for example. So they had a vague notion that elsewhere it was to be found, which is perhaps understandable because very few people have found a herb or an exercise or anything else at home that gave them immortality so far. So if it's not at home, hopefully it is somewhere else. So anyway, you see, then Joseph Needham also, in his discussion of this notion of longevity that the Chinese pursued with their exercises, that is not present in, for instance, Patanjali, but that is present in many modern manuals of Hatha Yoga, you know, that you increase your vitality, your longevity, and of course also your luster, your attractiveness for the opposite sex, which in the West is the absolutely number one reason why people take up yoga. You know, and yeah, but this is also mentioned in the Hatha Yoga classics, you know, that this is one of the effects of Hatha Yoga, you know, because that is what makes people do Hatha Yoga, and then hopefully later they will discover some more profound reasons, okay? But so, you see, all that, you know, Joseph Needham then starts to look for outside China. He says, you see, the Chinese clearly headed from somewhere, and that brings him to a study of the soma notion in the Rig Veda, where soma, of course, is also about immortality, about vitality, and so on. So perhaps India is in it for a little bit more than appears so far. And so anyway, this whole notion could only be integrated because India had a yoga tradition to begin with. Any remarks? Yes?
One question. After that, we'll have tea and then you can talk.